Good morning and welcome to St. Mark's Episcopal Church. I am Susie Abair, and we are so delighted to have you here in Richmond this morning for our Easter Sunday service. We have a few announcements I'd like to share with you. One is that starting the 12th through the 17th of April, we're going to be feeding the Richmond families of Fort Bend Family Promise. These are families that are being transitioned from homelessness into homes, and they are assisted through that ministry. We will be providing them with meals. We have 5 out of 7 meals lined up. If you're interested in helping out with providing a meal, please let me know. We also need drivers for 2 or 3 nights to deliver the meals to them in Richmond. So let me know and I will get you connected and set up on our schedule. Additionally, for most of this past year, we have only been distributing the host, but we now know that it is safe enough to also offer the common cup for intinction, which is dipping the host. So what we're going to do is, when it comes to that part of the service, come down your aisle and come up the center aisle, and there is the alcohol you can use, and then I will be over here to distribute the host. And then on the far side, John Ikey will have the cup, and you can choose to intinct or keep the host and proceed back to where you are. Please wear your mask as you come forward, and then we can all do this safely. We'll take our time, keep our spaces, and listen to beautiful music while we all partake of the Eucharist together this morning. We are simply delighted to have you, and let us worship God together.
Thank you.
Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Begotten Son, Jesus Christ, overcame death and opened to us the gate of everlasting life. Grant that we, who celebrate with joy the day of the Lord's resurrection, may be raised from the death of sin by your life-giving Spirit. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the reading.
The first reading is from Acts chapter 10. Peter began to speak to Cornelius and the other Gentiles. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is the Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 118. It is in your bulletin, and we will read it responsibly by half verse. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His mercy endures forever.
Let Israel now proclaim,
his mercy endures forever.
The Lord is my strength and my song,
and he has become my salvation.
There is a sound of exultation and victory
in the tents of the righteous.
The right hand of the Lord has triumphed.
The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord has triumphed.
I shall not die, but live,
and declare the works of the Lord.
The Lord has punished me sorely,
but he did not hand me over to death.
Open for me the gates of righteousness.
I will offer thanks to the Lord.
This is the gate of the Lord.
He is a righteous danger.
I will give thanks to you, for you answered me,
and have come on my salvation.
The same stone which the builders rejected has become
the chief cornerstone.
This is the Lord's doing,
and it is marvelous in our eyes.
On this day the Lord has acted.
We will rejoice and be glad in it.
The second reading is a letter from 1 Corinthians. I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved. If you hold firmly the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he also appeared to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciples set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, But the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes, but Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabuni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and to your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I have been worrying over my agapanthus. These are the fleshy-leaved, lush tropical plants that seem to be relatives of lilies. After the freeze, all of them throughout Houston turned into green mush. I waited a few weeks, and then I cut back the dead leaves and then proceeded to worry over those mushy stumps that were still left. And they, to be honest, are kind of like rotten onions. Time passed slowly, achingly slowly for me. A few green tips emerged, but nothing like the number of leaves that were there before. Every morning I have gone out and done a count. Three here, two there, one over there. Oh, there's a new one that's come up. The damage of the storm still dominates. The lushness from before, I still don't know whether it will return or not. The coming of spring has always held powerful metaphors for Christians. In the metamorphosis of caterpillars to butterflies, the dying back of the vegetation and the burst of green shoots from the ground, we are reminded of Jesus' death and resurrection. But the turning of the seasons, spring, summer, fall, and winter, it is cyclic. We will face the same seasonal changes with some variations again and again. Whereas with Jesus' death and resurrection, it is a once and for all event in human history, a pivoting point in all time. Jesus' death and resurrection is a permanent change, a permanent transformation. The coming of the season of spring is merely a modest reminder of the new life that we now live in as followers of Jesus. Spring after winter is a very mild echo of this crazy hope that we all cling to, that when we die, we will see our God face to face and not as a stranger. Our hope is grounded in Jesus breaking out of death and walking among the disciples. Death cannot hold him. In the pre-dawn light, the women go to the tomb armed with spices and perhaps also fresh linens. They're going to care for thoughtfully this time for their teacher's body, which was so hurriedly entombed before the Sabbath. Bravely going together, they come to the tomb and they find it empty of the body of Jesus. Instead, they find in the tomb a man, says Mark, and two men which are described as angels in John, who tell them that Jesus is no longer there. He is gone. Their sadness and determination and the gray light of dawn turn into sharp, fresh distress. Someone has taken the body of their Lord, they think. When Mary Magdalene comes to another man in the garden, she does not recognize him. And thinking he is the gardener, she begs, "Sir, if you know where they have taken him, please tell me." Jesus says to her, "Mary," and she recognizes the timbre of his voice. She hears her name being said by her Lord. She cries out, "Rabboni," which means teacher. She experiences that weak in the knees kind of joy, a personal, overwhelming wonder. Standing in front of her is the teacher that she loved, whom she saw die on the cross just 2 days earlier. The followers scurry all around. They're confused and afraid, and only gradually does it dawn on them what has actually happened. Jesus, their beloved teacher whom they saw die, is now alive. Astounding, unbelievable, and words spread of this throughout the disciples. Jesus is alive. It is definitely him. His body is still injured. It still carries the injuries that he incurred. What has happened here? Death is supposed to be final. Death and fear of it, it comes to us all. What has happened here? Jesus, who was just a few days ago breaking bread and sharing wine, declaring them to be his body and blood, who washed the feet of the disciples, who told them in essence, "You call me teacher, then do as I do." Wash each other's feet. In essence, serve one another, love one another. This Jesus is not in the tomb. What has happened here? Are we still standing around confused and fearful like Mary, expecting the worst after all we have gone through? It is so very hard to hope this year. We have lived with fear. We've had so many scares. We've experienced deaths of so many of friends and family. We have lost a year of our lives, lost time with friends, lost jobs, lost confidence, and we have seen some heart-rendingly ugly behavior this year. It is so very hard to forgive. It is hard to let go of the past. It is hard to hope. To hope is to risk. Will there be another surge? Will people come back to church? Will another dear friend or family member get ill before they can get vaccinated? We feel so vulnerable to injury after what has happened this year. Like Mary, perhaps you are having trouble seeing Jesus standing there alive right in front of us, because terrible events still play in our minds. But notice, Jesus breaks through Mary's despair when he speaks her name. She recognizes him. She believes. And this is God's work. This is God's intention. This is God's power. Here is resurrected life in the face of tragic events. Such life is promised for all who believe and follow him. In the face of despair, even in the face of death, in the face of human depravity and hatefulness, Jesus lives. We are a resurrection people. We know suffering, but we lean into hope. As Bishop Doyle says, we live cruciform lives. Or as Bishop Michael Curry says, in the face of great suffering, let us say hallelujah anyway. In his resurrection from the dead, Jesus provides us with this ultimate hope. We can dare to trust in his promise to bring us to himself. Resurrection then becomes a recurring theme in our lives. We aim for it. We believe in it. We trust in it. Because of God's extraordinary love for us. Because of the resurrection, we look for joy after suffering. We seek release after imprisonment. We search for hope after despair. We rejoice in community after isolation. We rustle up food for empty bellies. We offer comfort in the face of grief. This is resurrection. Death loses, love wins. So even in the midst of this difficult and sometimes ugly year, claim that crazy hope. God is in this struggle with us, and he has done this huge work to save us from ourselves. We are people of the resurrection. Jesus is alive. Alleluia, alleluia.
Prayers of the People are Form 6 and can be found in your bulletin. In peace we pray to you, Lord God, for all people in their daily life and work,
for our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone,
for this community, the nation, and the world,
and for all who work for justice, freedom, and peace,
for the just and proper use of your creation,
for the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression,
for all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble,
for those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy,
for the peace and unity of the Church of God,
for all who proclaim the gospel, and all who seek the truth,
for Michael, our presiding bishop, and Andy, Jeff, Kay, and Hector, our bishops, and for all bishops and other ministers,
for all who serve God in his church,
for the special needs and concerns of this congregation.
We pray for Jean, for Bill, for others that we name at this time,
for Deborah, Amy, for Keith, for George, for Ann, for Ashley,
Lonnie, Mary Lynn, Joe.
Those for whom the daughters of the King pray. Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life.
We give thanks for this gathered group of wonderful people.
We will exalt you, O God, our King.
and praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them
who put their trust in you.
O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
We have one birthday to celebrate today, and that is Harris. Harris is having a birthday this week. Let us pray for him. O God, our times are in your hand. Look with favor, we pray, on your servant Harris as he begins another year. Grant that he may continue to grow in wisdom and grace, and strengthen his trust in your goodness all the days of his life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. We also have an anniversary to celebrate, and that is Chris and Shan. Let us pray for them. O God, you have so consecrated the covenant of marriage that in it is represented the spiritual unity between Christ and his church. Send therefore once again upon these your servants your blessings, that they may continue to love, honor, and cherish each other in faithfulness and patience, in wisdom and true godliness, that their home may continue to be a haven of blessing and peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
We also continue to pray for those who are absent from us out of caution, and we pray for them. O God, whose fatherly care reaches to the uttermost parts of the earth, we humbly beseech you graciously to behold and bless those whom we love, now absent from us. Defend them from all dangers of soul and body, and grant that both they and we, drawing nearer to you, may be bound together by your love in the communion of your Holy Spirit, and in the fellowship of your saints, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Thank you.
Of your
you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself, in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is God. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, Hallelujah.
Let us pray. Eternal God,
Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as the new members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with the spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness.
The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you this day and always. Amen.
Oh,
the world, rejoicing in the power of the Spirit.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.